welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, the first non-professional astronauts to complete spacewalks have returned to Earth. Brian Lynn tells us about the historic mission. Anna Mateo presents this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. And Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins present the Lesson of the Day. But first,
the four-member crew of a private spaceflight has returned to Earth after a trip that included the first ever spacewalks by non-professional astronauts. American business leader Jared Isaacman organized and paid for the five-day mission, called Polaris Dawn. The American company SpaceX was a partner in the operation. It built both the Crew Dragon capsule and the Falcon 9 rocket that carried it to space. The capsule dropped into the Gulf of Mexico near Florida early Sunday as planned. The mission is historic for two reasons. First, Crew Dragon reached a top altitude of more than 1,400 kilometers. That was the highest level any crewed mission has reached since the American Space Agency NASA's Apollo program ended in the early 1970s. Second, two crew members completed spacewalks during the mission. Isaacman was first to pop his head out of the Crew Dragon capsule on September 12th. He spent about 10 minutes with the top half of his body outside the capsule as the spacecraft orbited hundreds of kilometers above Earth. A video camera captured Isaacman saying at the time, "Back at home, we all have a lot of work to do, but from here, Earth sure looks like a perfect world." SpaceX engineer Sarah Gillis took a turn after Isaacman returned. During each spacewalk, the astronauts kept their feet positioned inside the spacecraft. They moved their bodies in several exercises to test their spacesuits. Until Polaris Dawn, only government astronauts and cosmonauts in government service had completed spacewalks. The other Polaris Dawn crew members were SpaceX engineer Anna Menon and Scott Poteet, a retired American Air Force officer. They did not leave the spacecraft. However, they wore the same kind of spacesuits as Isaacman and Gillis. They needed the protection as the capsule environment was depressurized for the spacewalks. Isaacman had said a main goal of the mission would be to test the new spacesuit design in preparation for long-term stays in space. SpaceX has said the suits are equipped with the latest data-gathering instruments, as well as cameras and improved mobility systems. Before the mission launched, SpaceX said the crew planned to carry out a series of experiments aboard the Crew Dragon capsule. Among these were a test of laser-based satellite communication between the spacecraft and Starlink, SpaceX's internet satellite system. The laser method, which has also been tested by NASA, is designed to greatly increase space communication speeds. Many of the experiments dealt with observations of how human health is affected during long space missions. Among these will be tests with special contact lenses containing microelectronics that can continuously identify changes in eye pressure and shape. Isaacman is the head of payment processing company Shift for Payments. He has an estimated personal worth of $2 billion. Isaacman has not said publicly how much he paid SpaceX for its service. Polaris Dawn is the first of three planned missions under the Polaris program. The second will also use a Dragon capsule, while the third and final is expected to use SpaceX's Starship rocket. SpaceX chief Elon Musk has said his company plans to use Starship to carry future space travelers to the Moon and Mars. I'm Brian Lynn.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Actor Alicia Silverstone worried fans on social media recently. While on a trip to England, she posted a TikTok video of herself tasting a poisonous berry she found along a sidewalk. Silverstone, who appeared in the 1995 movie Clueless, said she thought the fruit was a tomato. But when she bit into it and found that it had an unusual taste, she realized that it was not the common food. Plant expert Jessica Damiano recently wrote about poisonous plants that look like common foods for the Associated Press. She said the fruit that looked like a tomato appears to have been a Jerusalem cherry. Often sold as a houseplant, all parts of the Jerusalem cherry are poisonous. The American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals says the plant is not only harmful to humans, but also to dogs, cats, and horses. Eating large amounts can be deadly. Silverstone was lucky because she did not swallow the berries. She is also lucky because the berries were reddish-orange. This means they were ripe. While all parts of the Jerusalem cherry are poisonous, the plant's unripe berries can be especially dangerous. They can cause problems with the central nervous and gastrointestinal systems. Symptoms from eating the fruit include mental confusion, stomach pain, high body temperature, vomiting, paralysis, and more. The Jerusalem cherry is a member of the nightshade family. It is in the same family of plants that includes tomatoes, eggplants, peppers, potatoes, and tomatillos. Although the fruits of those crops are safe to eat, their leaves are toxic. The Jerusalem cherry is not the only toxic plant that looks like a safe one. The poisonous Carolina horse nettle fruit also looks like a tomato. However, its common name is a dead giveaway that it is dangerous. It is called devil's tomato. It is also known as devil's potato to add to the confusion. Other members of the nightshade family are poisonous in different ways. For example, a plant named deadly nightshade, or belladonna, is so toxic that it was used as a murder weapon in Europe during the Middle Ages, a time more than 500 years ago. Its berries, however, could be mistaken for blueberries. Pokeweed and Virginia creeper fruits also look like blueberries, and both can be deadly if eaten. Lilies are toxic, but they look like edible wild onion or garlic grasses, especially when they first come out of the ground. Edible wild onion and garlic grasses have other toxic look-alikes too, including a plant sometimes called death camas. These plants grow in lawns and wild areas in the spring, and they are a common cause of livestock poisoning. They are dangerous for humans too. Toxic carrot and parsley look-alikes can also make you sick. Wild parsnip have flowers like a carrot and leaves like parsley. Simply touching it can cause a skin problem called photodermatitis. It causes sun sensitivity that can last for a year. Poison hemlock looks similar but is much larger. Eating that plant can lead to breathing problems. Creeping buttercup looks like flat-leaf parsley. It is an invasive plant that can cause severe stomach pain, vomiting, diarrhea, and heart problems. And the deadly Canadian moonseed can be confused with wild grape. However, its taste is so bitter that you would likely spit it out before swallowing it. This is a good thing because eating it can lead to death. If you think you have swallowed a toxic plant by mistake, contact a poison control center in your area or your doctor. There is additional information on the website poison.org. Damiano advises to use common sense with plants you find in the wild. If you are not completely sure that something is food, do not eat it. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
Ana Mateo is here now to talk more about this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Welcome, Ana.
Hello, Ashley. Thanks for inviting me.
So, actor Alicia Silverstone posted a video of herself on social media tasting what she thought was a tomato, except it was not.
That's right. It wasn't a tomato. The Associated Press plant expert Jessica Damiano said it looked like a Jerusalem cherry, which is poisonous, the entire plant, but especially its unripe berries.
Your report this week says that Silverstone tried a ripe berry, but didn't swallow it. Why is that?
Damiano explains in her story that the berries can taste odd. They are a little hot or peppery. So the actor spit it out.
Taste is a warning sign for other poisonous look-alike plants, right?
Yes, a poisonous plant called moonseed can be confused with wild grape. However, it tastes very bitter.
The other warning signs of these plants are their names. Devil's potato, deadly nightshade, deadly camas.
Yes, but a name with deadly or death is not helpful if you do not know what the plant looks like. Some of these poisonous plants look like carrots, parsnips, parsley, wild onion, and garlic. Very common, edible, meaning you can eat them, plants.
So you really need to know what these plants look like if you go collecting food in the wild.
Absolutely. And I really like the plant expert's advice. If you don't know what it is, don't eat it.
That is very wise advice. Well, thank you again, Anna, for coming on the show today. And thanks for that report.
Thanks for having me. I really enjoyed talking about this topic.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
After years of pushing electronic devices in classrooms, the country of Finland has moved back to using printed books to help students keep their focus on schoolwork. The country begins a new school year with the hope of returning to good results in the schools. Learning English's Jill Robbins will tell us more about this push for books in tomorrow's education report.
Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Today's lesson has three parts. First, you will hear and repeat a few informal expressions Anna uses that are very common in American English.
Next, you will hear Andrew and me having a native speaker conversation.
Third, you'll get to practice hearing and listening to phrases that begin with the word what.
We have a lot to do in today's lesson, so let's get started. Here's Anna in lesson 19. When she learns that she is going to make a new TV show.
I have a new assignment for you. Your skills are perfect for a new show. A children's show.
A children's show. That is awesome! When do I start?
You start next month. Start thinking of ideas for the show.
I have tons of ideas. I can show children what it's like in outer space. or...
Great!
Tons of is an informal way of saying a lot of. A ton, in the units of weight used in the United States, is 2,000 pounds, which is about 907 kilograms. So that's why a ton of, or tons of, means a lot, or very many.
Anna has a lot of imagination, so she has tons of ideas.
I have tons of ideas.
And there are tons of things we can talk about based on the Let's Learn English series from VOA Learning English.
Here's some more examples with the expression tons of. So, Andrew, I'm going to Charlotte, North Carolina next weekend for a work meeting. But I haven't had time to plan my trip, and I don't really know what to do.
Oh, don't worry about that. There's tons to do. There are more than one really good art museums downtown. There are major sports teams. There's an NBA basketball team, an NFL football team, soccer teams. There's a very good symphony orchestra and a lot of good restaurants. You will have plenty to do.
Yeah, I'm sure I will.
Hey, I meant to ask you, could you help me move my office furniture if you're not too busy?
Yeah, no problem. I've got tons of time. Speaking of the office, do you have any paper clips?
Oh, I've got tons of them. Take all you want.
Andrew, pretty soon our listeners will have tons of examples.
That's true. I think they probably get the idea. But they should remember that tons of is a little bit informal, and it is used more in speaking than in formal writing.
That's true. So how about teaching another informal expression?
Well, how about?
Yeah, we can do that. Here's Anna and Jeannie in lesson 14. Anna needs some clothes to wear, and a genie appears and tries to help.
Tonight, I am going to the theater with my friends, but I don't know what clothes to wear. Maybe this magazine can help. Her clothes are beautiful. I really want a friend like her to help me. Who are you?
I am Jeannie. You want help? I am here to help you find the right clothes.
Awesome! How about jeans and a t-shirt?
No! Jeans and a t-shirt are too casual. How about something more formal?
Sure!
When Anna says, how about, she means, what if we try this?
Awesome! How about jeans and a t-shirt?
And when we speak quickly, we sometimes drop the sound from about and just say bout. So it sounds like this. How about this?
Or how about that?
How about we listen to Anna one more time?
Can you put on a jacket?
Why not?
I love the jacket. How about a hat?
I think we can find tons of examples of people saying, how about?
I'm sure we can. But how about we do something else? There's something Anna says at the end of lesson 19 that we could talk about for our native speaker conversation. Let's listen.
I have tons of ideas. I can show children what it's like in outer space. Or...
Great!
In the deep, dark ocean.
Those are great ideas. Anna, please go think of more at your desk.
Yes. What other things can I show them? Mount Everest. Everyone has different skills. You have skills, I have skills. The important thing is to know what you are good at. Until next time.
I think Anna has some useful advice. It is important to know what you are good at.
Yeah, for example, last week, I realized that I'm good at catering. You know, like setting up food and tables for a party. It's probably something I learned from watching my mother. Let's move on to our third topic for today. Phrases that start with the word what.
Grammatically, these are called noun clauses. But you don't have to worry about the name. Just listen to the word order. You hear the word what, then you hear a subject followed by a verb.
Here's Anna again in lesson 19, excited that she's going to have a new TV show. The noun clause is at the end.
A children's show. That is awesome! When do I start?
You start next month. Start thinking of ideas for the show.
I have tons of ideas. I can show children what it's like in outer space.
When she says, what it's like, you hear the word what, plus the subject, it, plus the verb, is, using the contraction form, it's.
So normally, when we ask a question with words such as what or where, the verb comes before the subject, like when we say, what is your name? But if we put the what or where inside a sentence or statement, the subject and verb change places, like this. I want to know what your name is.
The words, what your name is, are the object of the verb know. So their job in the sentence is to function like a noun instead of a question. So that's why the word order is not like a question with what.
It can be tricky to reverse the subject and verb order correctly. But don't worry, we're going to give you tons of examples.
I can show children what it's like in outer space.
And how about these examples?
I can show you what I want. I can show you what I need. I can tell you what I think. I can tell you what I see.
You can show me what you want. You can show me what you need. You can tell me what you think. You can tell me what you see.
I can tell you what to do. I can tell you where to go.
You can?
Yes, I can.
Go ahead. Tell me some more.
I can tell you what time it is. I can tell you what the weather is. I can tell you what my cat likes to eat. I can tell you where my cat likes to sleep. I can tell you what it's like to watch the moon and stars at night. I can tell you what I want. I can tell you what I need. But I can't tell you what to do because that's really up to you.
You know, I think that's true. You can't tell me what to do, but you can give me some good advice.
Well, here's some advice for our listeners. Practice repeating the sentences you hear on this lesson of the day. And use the Let's Learn English series to find many more examples of things you can learn to say.
That is some good advice. We hope you've enjoyed today's lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.